Sue Stockdale, and welcome to the Access to Inspiration podcast, the show where you can gain inspiration from people who may be unlike you. We hope their stories and insights enable you to transcend day-to-day challenges and reflect on what you are capable of achieving. On the podcast today, I'm speaking to John Miles. John's co-founder of iWorker, a social enterprise that began with the aim of providing quality work to Venezuelans. It enables entrepreneurs and small businesses to hire talented remote workers who are highly educated and have a range of skills. Often called virtual assistants or VAs, this type of resource is really becoming very popular now, particularly with small businesses that are growing or need flexible resource. In fact, Matthias, who's a key member of our Access to Inspiration team, works remotely with us from Argentina to edit and produce the podcasts. So I'm certainly familiar with this concept. Welcome, John, to the podcast.
Thank you very much for having me, Sue.
Now, I know that you're a bit of a traveler and have a global focus, and that this business initially was started around South America. What took you to South America in the first place?
I was involved in a couple of businesses back in Canada, and I just had the opportunity to sell the ownership in those businesses at one time. And this was about 3 years ago. And so I had always thought, like a lot of people, I had fantasized about traveling, and you hear the stories of people traveling the world and just working from their laptop. And that sounded pretty cool to me. And so I actually had the opportunity to do that when I sold my shares in these businesses. So I thought, well, what do I want to do? I really like being in business. So I said, okay, I'm going to start a new business of some kind. And where are some of the places that I've been that I think would be interesting to go to? So Buenos Aires, Argentina was on the top of that list, as was Medellin, Colombia. And what appealed to me was just I wanted to learn another language so I could actually talk to locals and experience a bit of a different culture. So I thought, okay, well, Spanish is a valuable language. It's useful all over the world. So, okay, I'm going to learn Spanish. And Medellin and Buenos Aires were two cities that I had been to that I really liked. So I went down to Buenos Aires for 4 months, got an apartment. And it was down there that I met my now business partner, Jeb. We actually didn't start this business right away. He was working on other things and I was doing a bit of consulting. But we got talking and we hit it off. And we had been sort of talking and seeing. Well, we'll jump into this maybe a little bit later, but we had met a lot of people from Venezuela and then got the spark for the idea to start this business. But that's how I ended up in South America.
And I know you're speaking to us today from Medellin in Colombia, and it's lovely to hear the birds tweeting in the background. We really get a great sense of what that city must be like for you.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, like palm trees everywhere, super green, and just birds everywhere. It's really quite something.
It sounds lovely. I know you were saying that you and Jeb are hearing stories from people in Venezuela about what the situation was like there and the economic crisis. What were you learning from people coming from Venezuela?
You hear all sorts of things. Some of the typical stories, and the situation changes really quickly, but something that's super common is just really long lineups for groceries. So things that you couldn't even imagine, like waiting for 4 hours to get into a grocery store to get food. And then you get in and they don't have a lot of the stuff that you want. Or it's just so expensive to buy certain things. Like some certain things are not expensive, but then certain things are just ridiculously expensive. And so it makes just things that we take for granted super difficult. Another one is getting money out of a bank machine. So the government will limit how much cash people can take out. And you can wait for 3 hours to get to go to the bank teller and get cash out. And then you'll get enough cash to, I don't know, buy a sandwich type of thing. So it's just everything that we take for granted that you can do just super quickly and super easily is difficult. There's also the safety factor. So going out in the street, the crime rate's a lot higher. It's in a lot of the bigger cities like Caracas. So that's certainly a factor. The public transit system can either be not working or just, again, you have to dedicate a lot of time to being able to get where you want to go. So we're talking hours to get places. And then the country has gone through different waves where food has gotten really expensive, but then that problem at times has seemed to work itself out. But then other problems come up where they have issues with maybe electricity went out for a few days across the whole country at one point. So it just seems to be problem after problem. Luckily, they haven't been hit too hard by the coronavirus yet, but the medical system there is in poor shape. And so you can just imagine anything that is a small problem can really grow into bigger issues.
So you and Jeb were hearing these stories coming out of Venezuela. And now many other people could have heard similar things and just had a degree of empathy for those in the country. How did you get from hearing those stories to deciding to start up a business?
Part of it was that we had some friends that were Venezuelan and they had fled Venezuela, and we got to know them in Buenos Aires. And Jeb and I were both in different but similar positions, that Jeb was doing well with a few online businesses that he had. And I had just sold my shares in these businesses. So we weren't under the gun to do something new and make a ton of money off of it. So this happened more where we didn't have these grand plans to start a huge business. We just said, okay, yeah, like we've got a bit of time. We could probably help some people out, like, yeah, help some of these Venezuelan friends of ours out, because we've got a foot in both worlds. We're living in South America. We know some people. We know a bit about the culture, but we're North American business people. I'm from Canada and Jeff's from the US, and we're entrepreneurial, and we can have those conversations with entrepreneurs back home and speak the same language. And so we thought, okay, we're in maybe a unique position, so why don't we just try this out, trying to make some of these connections with people we know down here, with friends and business owners back home. We just started doing it on the side, like small scale, but it took off like almost from the beginning. We didn't have a website. We didn't have anything. We were just talking to people, and we saw that the demand was there, and it built from there.
So in terms of the setup of the enterprise, I know you describe it as a social enterprise, which one might argue is making money and making a difference. Which one's more important for you?
We started this for sure making a difference. The reason for that is, as I say, like we weren't starting this to get rich, or that just wasn't our goal from the beginning. So we decided, okay, we're going to take a small margin. We've never changed that. And actually, we have plans to decrease the margin as the business becomes more established and we're getting some things with economies of scale and that sort of thing that allows us to pour more money back. And we've given substantial raises to all of our workers, and that's super important to us. So if we have any extra cash, pour that back into giving workers raises, because that's our ultimate goal, is to pay people as much money as we can. So we've got our P&L, and then we've got a couple special lines on our profit and loss that show how much money we've paid out to the workers since day one, and then show how many workers we've given work to in total and how many workers we currently have working. So for us, those metrics are super important.
So you are really trying to make a difference as well as make sure that the business makes money at least.
Yeah, exactly.
So for those listeners that don't understand or haven't heard about the idea of VAs, virtual assistants, tell us about what is the kind of service that you're selling.
VAs is quite a broad term, actually. And on our website, we use more remote worker or remote professional. The reason for that is that we feel it encompasses more of what the workers are capable of doing. Because if you're a virtual assistant, you're just like, someone who can do basic things like, I don't know, book a flight for me or find a hotel or whatever it may be. Most of our workers are college, university educated. We have workers with master's degrees. We have workers who are at least a couple that are lawyers, at least a couple that are medical doctors that work with us on the side. And so that's why I say remote professional. It gives you an idea that, okay, they're capable of all sorts of different things. It's almost anything that a worker can do on a computer. So the common things would be social media, customer service, sales, lead generation, graphic design, digital marketing is really quite popular, like SEO, and then doing web development. So a lot of it is on WordPress, but also like application development.
So if I was a business owner in the UK or anywhere in the world for that matter, and I was looking to get a resource to help me with my website or do some social media for me, would I be then hiring one of your workers full time, or what would I be actually buying from them?
Not full time. And that's one of the advantages to, I think, hiring from a company like ours, is just we will do everything we can to fill that worker's schedule. So if they want to get 40 hours a week, we can put them with a few different people to get them up to those 40 hours a week. But you don't have to commit to 40 hours. So if you only want 5 hours or 10 hours a week, that's fine. We chunk off that time. And then that worker becomes a member of your team. We're not swapping them out. But you don't have to commit to trying to find them other work to do just so that they can get by. But because they're working with us, we're probably filling their schedule in other places. And so there's that commitment that this is actually their full-time job, their career. So we get that commitment of us being their full-time employer, but you don't have to commit to the full-time hours. So that can be quite powerful.
Now that makes sense, John. And in terms of language, you talked earlier about obviously the main predominant languages being Spanish and Portuguese in South America. How do you cope with that potential language barrier when maybe your clients are, I'm imagining, mostly English speaking?
So we are particular about who we hire. So as much as we operate as a social enterprise, I realize from being an entrepreneur myself, it's not easy to grow a business. So we expect our workers to be reliable, to have some skill set that's marketable, and then have advanced level English. So we've had probably 5,000 people apply with us, and we've got a team of, I think, around 400. So by all means, we don't hire everybody that applies. As much as we'd like to, we realize, okay, English, having a high level of English is super important for communication and all that sort of thing. So
tell us about some of the challenges in the early days, because I can imagine trying to set up a business like you've got and satisfy the requirements on both sides might have been a little bit tricky at the start.
Yeah, well, you sort of hit the nail on the head when you said both sides, because the biggest thing for us in the beginning, and actually it still can be a challenge, but we're getting more and more in the groove as time goes on, but knowing, okay, because you can't hire a bunch of workers overnight, and we'll go in waves where we've got all these workers and we're trying to find work for them, and then we'll go in waves where we have all this demand, and then we're like, oh, we don't have enough workers. So trying to predict that and see, okay, where are we going to need to be in 4 weeks type of thing with the number of workers. We don't want to be recruiting and getting workers' hopes up, and then it's like, oh, we sort of overshot. We have too many people and we can't find you work. It's disappointing, and we don't want to waste anybody's time. So just that side of that has been our biggest challenge, probably, is just balancing both sides of it and making sure that we're not doing too much of one activity.
And I also imagine that as the person that requires the service from the worker, so let's imagine the British company again, that it's not necessarily a case of just saying, okay, John, here's my website, update it every week for me, and that's the level of briefing that is expected or will deliver the result. I'm imagining there's a bit more to it than that.
Yeah. So that's the biggest factor when people ask me, okay, like, how do I have a successful relationship with a remote worker? And what I say is, okay, you need to treat this person as if it's somebody that you're hiring. Let's pretend that you have an office in Britain and you're paying them whatever they're going wages, 50,000 pounds a year, whatever it may be. So you need to invest that same amount of time in this remote worker, even though they're in a different country and you haven't met them in person and you're paying them significantly less. They're still, in a lot of cases, going to be equally educated and have the same sort of skills and potential. So you have to realize that and foster it. And part of that is just investing the time in the beginning to, as you would with somebody if you hired them in person. And that's how you're going to get the result of bringing the best out of them and get a worker that's just as valuable. In the extreme example, I've seen cases where somebody will hire a worker and then they just do up a Google document. On the worker's first day, they send them an email and say, okay, here are the instructions of what I want you to do. And I sort of equate that to if you hired a worker to work in your office and then they come in for their first day of work and you just leave a piece of paper on their desk and you're like, this is what I want you to do. Nobody would do that. Like, you spend time with them and you show them around the office and you check in on them during the first day and the second day. You make sure that they don't have any questions, they're on the right track. So you want to do the same thing with a combination of calls and then check-ins, whether you're communicating with them on Skype or Slack or whatever it may be, and just check in with them, over-communicate during the first week, 2 weeks, and expect the same from the worker and say, I want to hear from you every day on what you're working on. And do you have any questions? Do you have any things you don't understand? If you over-communicate in the beginning, it takes a bit more time, but you're going to get way quicker to the point where the worker's autonomous and you really don't have to babysit them at all.
I'm imagining what you're saying there, John, are wise words for anybody listening to this podcast and is having to work with their staff remotely because of the coronavirus challenge as well.
Yeah, communication's key. And it's something I remind myself of because everybody's busy. And so it's easy to just, you think, okay, the most efficient thing is just a few words, send them a message on Slack and get on with your day. But sometimes what ends up being the most efficient doesn't seem like it on the surface. Again, I'm guilty of that. I've hired workers that are awesome workers and have performed really well for clients, and they become available and we bring them on within their business. And I set them up and then it's not going the way I wanted. And I look back and I'm like, okay, the problem here is me, because I look at the instructions and I'm like, okay, I rushed that and I wasn't clear on what I'm looking for. So I totally understand it. But yeah, I can say certainly that investing that extra time training them is key.
I guess I'm hearing there's responsibility on both sides there to make sure that communication works. Now, as an entrepreneur, John, I'm imagining that, you know, I've met many in my time in business that they are often then looking for the next venture. So they're great at startup and then they want to get on to the next thing. With that in mind, what are the strengths that you bring to the business? And then I guess, where do you see you're adding most value to iWorker?
I think I'm sort of well-rounded. I'm comfortable with technology and I'm comfortable with learning. I know that I have a lot of weaknesses and I'm not afraid to sort of face them and try and improve. So maybe that's my biggest strength, is just that I'm not afraid to learn new things and try new things. And then I'll say my business partner, Jeb, is an exceptional communicator, which really helps. We're now not answering all of our customer service emails, but he's put great systems in place to train our workers on how to communicate properly. And I would say that those are maybe the skills that we bring to the table. And then we have a lot of experience between Jeb and I outsourcing. And so that's been really powerful for us because as we get more and more clients, we can't handle them all. Like we used to, I used to know every client and every worker. And we've gotten to the point where that's not possible to do all that communication, but we have enough experience setting up the systems and outsourcing them so we can grow and we can handle as much demand as there is just by nature of outsourcing.
Do you outsource to yourself? As in
workers. Yeah. Anytime a really good worker comes available, we're like, okay, how can we fit them into this business? Because it's just like a magic potion when you've got somebody who's really exceptional. It's incredible.
I'm imagining word of mouth is a strong way of communicating amongst the iWorkers, a good organization to be part of.
Yeah. Because there's a huge trust factor. We realize, okay, when clients come to us, like we're not a huge brand, like Fiverr or Upwork. So most people maybe haven't heard of us. So we know that, okay, we need to show them that we're a legitimate business. So part of that is us being accessible. So I'm willing to jump on a call with anybody who's interested and all of our clients and that sort of thing. And then on the same side with workers, as you touched on there, people sometimes forget that the workers, when they're looking for work online, there's so many scam jobs and jobs where they risk working and not getting paid. And I've heard so many stories of that. And so word of mouth is big. We've had a lot of workers come in through friends that are working with us or family that are working with us because they know, okay, this person's enjoying the job. They get treated well. They get paid on time and all that sort of thing. So it certainly is a big way that we do recruiting and then also a big way that we find clients.
So it sounds like the values that you have for how you make a difference, if you like, also apply to how you treat the people that are part of your team, the workers and the clients.
Yeah, it's huge. It's huge. And so we started with that in mind because that was the goal. It had unintended, really positive consequences. We thought, okay, we're just going to pay people well and obviously just treat people well because that's the right thing to do. And in doing so, I think it was like maybe a year before we had any worker leave. And I'm like, this is insane because I've run businesses for 10 years, let's say, and it's part of turnover. No matter, like you pay people well, but they go and find something else or they get bored or whatever it is. I'm like, I can't believe that we have whatever it was at that time, 50 workers and nobody's left. And so I'm like, so we must be doing something right. And we were having, people refer their friends and family because we started it not with the goal of making a ton of money. We're just like, okay, yeah, let's pay the workers as much as we can and keep our margin as low as we can and just run super lean. And we realized, okay, yeah, we're actually people really like working for us. And we got some really nice messages from people at Christmas time or New Year's and just saying, oh, yeah, it's been a great year. So that was an unintended consequence, but treating people well has paid off in the sense it's just made our lives easier for running a business.
What do you enjoy about it, John? What do you get from it? What's your motivation?
Almost everything. I love the entrepreneurial aspect of it. I love that the business has just gone really smoothly. Of course, we've had problems, but I think because we're coming at it with good intentions that the clients realize, okay, if something doesn't go perfectly well, like they know that we're trying our best and we're big on communicating and we work really hard to try and fix things. We haven't had really any friction on the client side. And then again, because I think we've got good intentions with the recruiting, we've found that people can realize that we're genuine in the way that we advertise like in our job postings and all that sort of thing. So yeah, we've been able to hire tons of good workers. So it's just been a really smooth process, relatively speaking, running the business. And then it's been fun to help people for sure. Or maybe fun's not the right word, but yeah, it is nice to know that we've been able to give people jobs. They've been able to save money and leave Venezuela if that's their goal. Like we have a lot of workers that have left Venezuela because they know, okay, I can leave the country, move to wherever, Chile, and I'm not going to have to go through a period without having work. Right when I arrive, I can open my laptop and continue working and continue making money.
You're really positively impacting people's lives by what you do.
I hope we are. I think we've definitely got some stories that I think would show that.
With the way the world is today, Venezuela isn't the only country. It's an economic crisis. So what are your plans for supporting other countries? Or do you work with workers from other countries already?
We do, yeah. So about a year and a half ago, I think it would be, we really started to focus as much as like Venezuela was our main goal. And now we made he started as a virtual assistant, Enrique, but we made him a partner in the business. He's now on our website if you go there and see. So he's one of the first people that we hired. He's Venezuelan. Venezuela is super important to us because that was our main focus. But we've also realized that, okay, some other countries, certainly there's a lot of economic need in countries like Zimbabwe with really high inflation rates. And so we said, okay, we can sort of stay true to this original focus, but it doesn't have to be just Venezuela. And there are some other countries that have really skilled workers with particular skill sets. So yeah, we've hired workers from all over South America. We've hired workers from the Caribbean, from Haiti, Dominican Republic. About a year ago, we started hiring workers from Africa. So we have workers from a number of different countries in Africa. We have a few in India, maybe one or two from the Philippines, but there are lots of companies that cover the Philippines. So Asia is not a huge focus for us.
My final question to you, John, is what are the plans for the future then? Where do you see this ultimately ending up as a business?
I wish I had some like grand vision, but I think it's more of the same. Like, we just really enjoy what we're doing. And as tempting as it is, you sort of touched on earlier, like entrepreneurs are always looking for the next thing. But we're like, okay, this is working quite well. Let's not get too tempted by the next shiny object and really change what we're doing. So let's focus on our strengths, double down on those, pick apart our system as much as we can and figure out where our weaknesses are and try and shore those up. But just keep on with the same business model, keep serving the same market, because I think the market has lots of potential. There are tons more clients that we can access. And so our focus is trying to reach more of the same clients and just spread the word as much as we can. And then in doing so, it'll allow us to provide more work for more people.
Fantastic. Well, I hope that the listeners to this podcast will be one route that will help spread the word about your organization. How can people find you on social media if they want to know more about iWorker?
I'm one of the few people who's not huge on social media. So I'd say just go to our website, iWorker.co, not .com, but .co. And that's where you can find us and you can communicate with us. We've got a chat functionality on there and respond most of the day. And then email. And people want to speak to me directly, feel free to send us an email or something through the contact form and just say that they'd like to jump on a call or whatever it may be, Skype message. And I'm happy to talk to anybody if they want. But we have a great team. So
thank you so much for your time today, John. It's been really interesting to hear about what you're doing and the difference you're making in these countries.
Well, thank you very much, Sue. I appreciate it.
Well, that was such an interesting story about how John and his friend spotted an opportunity to help workers in Venezuela, and that you can also make money as well as making a difference, which they are clearly doing. What did it make you reflect on in your life? As always, if you enjoyed this podcast, please take a moment to leave us a review on Apple Podcasts or whatever platform you're using. And if you recommend the podcast to just one more person, that will help us to continue to reach more listeners and give them access to inspiration. In the next episode, I will be talking to Alicia Silberg, originally from South Africa and now a Silicon Valley venture capitalist. She'll be telling me about her upbringing and how that has influenced how she operates as a businesswoman today. I hope you will join me then.